so we're going to, this is like thinking back to those squiggly line graphs we drew yesterday in class with the twiddling the knob in Russian on the computer. And we tried two different resistors.
Twiddling
so
the knob in Russian.
The resistors of the water cooled resistor, which was like a jar of water with a coil of wire in it. And as we cranked up the voltage on that, we saw that the current went up. And it was linearly proportional, like it went up by the same ratio, double the voltage, double the current. We got a beautiful straight line. And that was really different to when we popped up the light bulb. What we saw with the light bulb was that as the voltage went up, first the current went up fast, and then it went up slower and slower and slower as we increased the voltage. It's hard to talk about it when it's you've got the independent variable on the y-axis, the same. But the reason we put the voltage, even though we're twiddling the voltage knob and changing the voltage, we don't put it down here where we've normally got the independent variable, because we desperately want that the gradient is the resistance. That's really useful for us, that we can like look at the steepness of the graph and be like, damn, the steeper that graph is, the higher the resistance is. We can really easily understand what's going on. We can see that on a water-cooled resistor, that the resistance stayed constant no matter how much the voltage was. But on the light bulb, we can see that that gradient gets steeper and steeper and steeper. And because resistance is voltage over current, is rise over run, and the rise is the voltage and the run is the current, we can see that that steeper line means a greater resistance. And so what we learned from this is that when we hold the temperature fixed by like having a water cooled resistor, water has a really high heat capacity, so it doesn't heat up quickly at all, that resistance stays constant. Whereas the light bulb's like in a vacuum, as that heats up, that resistance was able to vary as the temperature of the wire inside the light bulb changed. So we've got two different like ways that a resistor can behave. This water-cooled resistor is what we call an ohmic resistor. Ohmic meaning it follows Ohm's law, which is that R equals V upon I, and that R is constant no matter what. So we can work out how much current we're going to get for a certain voltage knowing that resistance stays constant. The light bulb is a non-ohmic resistor, meaning that its resistance changes at different voltages and currents. So, to understand why this is happening, we're going to have a little think about what resistance is. So, if we have a piece of wire, what we're trying to do as current flows is get the electrons inside that wire. They experience the electric field. We apply a voltage to the wire. They experience that electric field. They each feel a little electric force tugging them along. And so they begin to accelerate down the wire. But inside this metal wire, the metal sits in like a crystalline lattice. And so that means that throughout this wire, sitting at kind of like fixed positions in a metal lattice, are the metal atoms. And so what's going to happen to these electrons as they go flying down that wire? What's going to happen? They're going to boom, smack into those metal atoms that are inside the crystal lattice. Every time they hit one, they stop. An electron's tiny and a metal atom's huge, and so stops, but it's still feeling the electric force, so gets re-accelerated. Hits another one, stops. And so resistance is just the how many collisions are happening, is like an indication of resistance. Resistance turns electrical energy into heat energy, because what happens to the kinetic energy of the electron when it hits the metal atom? Well, it sets that metal vibrating, and that increases the temperature of the resistor. So resistance turns electrical energy into heat energy. So your grandmother warms up her knees with the little electric heater that glows red. That's glowing red because the electrons are smacking into the atom, the metal atoms inside the wire.
So using that same example, can you explain why resistance is increased when temperature is increased?
We can, exactly. So the reason why The light bulb doesn't have constant resistance, is that as these electrons smack into the metal atoms, those metal atoms start to vibrate more and more, and as they vibrate more and more, that means that electrons are more likely to hit into them because they're kind of moving around there, creating a bigger target area for the electrons to hit, and so it's more difficult for the electrons to move through, or less likely for the electrons to move through the wire without having a collision, and so they collide more, and that heats up the wire more, the resistance gets greater and greater and greater. What are other things that we could change about a wire that would increase the resistance?
Make it smaller.
Make it thinner.
So the thinner the wire, the less area there is for the electrons to travel through, and so the greater the resistance. What else?
Does that work? Because wouldn't there still be like the same ratio of electrons to atoms if you just made the wire smaller? Or like the same number of electrons? The same number of atoms?
That's a good question. Okay, so what is the cross-sectional area of a resistor affect its resistance? Surely as we decrease the area, we're decreasing the number of electrons and the number of metal atoms proportionally. Well, we have to think about it in terms of the density of current. Like, as we decrease the area for putting the same amount of current through, we have to have a greater density of current in that resistor, and that means a greater probability of collisions, because with a greater density of current there's going to be more electrons per cross-sectional area, and those are going to have therefore a greater chance of crashing into atoms inside that metal lattice. What else can we change?
You can change the type of wire, like what it's made out of.
Yeah, we can change the type of wire. Like, different metals have different resistivities, which kind of depends on how likely the electron is to collide into a metal atom inside that crystalline lattice. What else?
The length of the wire?
The length of the wire. The longer the wire, the greater the probability of collisions happening for each electron, so the greater the resistance. So what we learned from this graph is that as temperature increases, metal atoms vibrate, likelihood of collisions between electrons and metal atoms increases, so resistance increases. And then just very briefly, looking at what resistance depends on, like of a metallic resistor, it's going to be different when we come and talk about like semiconductors, like silicon or graphite, weird things that we use to make diodes and transistors. But for a metal resistor, it depends on the length, the area, and the resistivity. And so as we increase the length, the resistance increases because there's going to be more collisions. As we increase the area, there's a greater space for those electrons to move through, and so the resistance decreases. And as we increase the resistivity of the wire, the likelihood of collisions increases, so the resistance increases. But those three factors are what it depends on. That we can calculate, not on your formula sheet, but resistance is equal to length over the area times by the resistivity. So that equation would let us calculate for any wire made of any material how much the resistance is, but we don't need to know that for this year. The questions about that?
Is that symbol next to the L just a random symbol, or is that a P or a backwards A, or
is it
just that?
Yeah, but what is the shape?
What's the green?
What's the
yeah, it's green. It's a
row.
Okay, right. I don't know if you could draw a P that was like sideways a little bit or whatever.
It's a row.
They all